As of the 1st of July, Australians will be relying on the House of Representatives to block the excesses of the Senate. Who would ever have thought? I'm sure our founding fathers never envisaged such an outcome. Nevertheless, it's a good reminder how a bicameral system provides vital safeguards. With a Labor-Green alliance running the Senate, it will fall to the House of Representatives, and in particular, the four independents, to determine our fate. It is a worrying time for our nation and for our federation. The uncertainty alone will impact on our economy if the Tasmanian experience is any guide. That is why it is opportune to have an occasion such as this, kindly provided by the Sydney Institute, to expose, examine, and explore the ramifications. On the 1st of September 2010, Australians witnessed the spectacle of Ms. Gillard and Senator Brown seated at a table, signing a document with wattle sprigs in their lapels and an adoring bridal party behind them, witnessing the occasion. The scene was suggestive of a civil marriage, albeit one of convenience. The published photograph of the event did hold my fascination. On studying it, I could not help but note its orchestration. The bowed heads, the folded hands of the witnesses, some smirking, but also the wary faces of the leaders, and the uncertainty suggested by the large doors behind, as if everyone could somehow go back inside and have another configuration emerge. I believe that picture tells us a lot about the alliance, and for this reason it has been so commented on and reproduced. But away from the photo, the deal itself has implications for our nation that are extremely worrying. So tonight I want to pose two questions. With whom are we dealing, and with what are we dealing? Hailing from Tasmania and having served in the Senate for slightly longer than Senator Brown, I have been in an unique position to observe the Greens and their leader for over three decades. Until now, their 15-second grabs, extreme policies and personal hypocrisies have been treated at best with indifference, or at worst, with gushing endorsement. Here are a few examples which together build a picture of the Greens. Whilst in themselves, individually, they may be overlooked, together they paint a picture of inconsistent behaviour and a misplaced sense of moral superiority. Here are some that I have recalled. It seems gagging parliamentary debates is to be condemned as a fundamental abrogation of the parliamentary process. That is, unless the Greens want to gag the coalition. Missing votes in the Senate is indicative of a party that is a rabble and a matter deserving media exposure. That is, unless it is the Greens leader who misses a vote. Bad behaviour and verbal insults in the parliament are to be condemned, unless they are in furtherance of a justifiable Green cause. All parliamentarians should be transparent and accountable. That is, unless you want to receive donations to a personal bank account, then file late returns and identify many donors as simply anonymous in furtherance of the cause, you understand. Receiving large donations taints political parties. That is, unless you are the beneficiary. Receiving donations from a particular source with an agenda prejudices a party's policy making. That is, unless you receive even larger donations from the CFMEU. Senators even need to have a dress code determined by the Senate. That is, unless you lose the motion and ignore the will of the Senate anyway. The use of timber for energy and biomass should be condemned. That is, unless you want a log fire for personal use. And the one that I did like, championing National Go Home on Time Day, is such an important principle that it demands a motion in the Senate. unless, on that very same day, your party moves an extension of Senate sitting hours to try to ram something through. These are just a smattering of the inconsistencies. Minor in themselves, granted, but very illuminating in that their frequency establishes a pattern of behaviour. Any other party and its leaders would have been hounded for such an array of double standards, as they should have been. But not so the Greens. That is, until very recently. I am gratified that the Greens are at last being given the scrutiny they deserve. For too long, the Greens have flown under the radar. Until now, simplistic and extremist policies and double standards have been overshadowed by the Greens' image of being well-meaning tree huggers. The new paradigm of scrutiny appears to have come as a shock to the Greens. First, we had Senator Brown labelling News Limited the hate media. Next was the disclosure that he repeatedly complained to ABC Managing Director Mark Scott about the ABC's 2010 coverage, something I found astounding, given that only 5 of the 982 complaints about the ABC's election coverage related to anti-Green bias, and those 5 had to do with inadequate coverage. Most recently, Senator Brown threateningly declared that he will take on the media which has, to quote him, crossed the line. The truth is that the Greens have crossed the line from the political margin into the mainstream, and after 30 years of largely uncritical media coverage, they are finding it difficult to adjust to the scrutiny some of us have had to put up with from day one. The illusion we are dealing with a benign group of people, naive in the ways of the world, needs to be debunked, and the quicker the better. No, the Greens are not a group of benign environmentalists, nor are koalas, threatened species and habitat top of their agenda. That is their cuddly facade. Too many of the organisers and activists within the Greens are simply unreconstructed old guard lefties. That is why the description watermelons is still so apt. A green layer covering a substantial red core. From your local Senator-elect Lee Rhiannon or the member for Melbourne, Adam Bandt, the Greens stand for uncompromising, old-style left-wing politics. The father of the Senate, Senator Ron Boswell, recently provided this following perceptive insight. Australia needs to work out very quickly that the Greens are the one nation of the left. Bob Brown is the socialist Pauline Hanson. The big and alarming difference between them lies in the public's perception. The danger represented by the extreme right position of Hanson and One Nation was clear from the very beginning. The flip side, the left-wing extremism of the Greens, is still largely under the radar. The Greens are still far too widely perceived as a benign political force. End of quote. Indeed, in Senator Hanson Young's intolerance of controls on illegal immigration, we see the flip side of her namesake's view that boat people should be turned away. Senator-elect Lee Rhiannon is the epitome of the Red-Green, an uncompromising inner-city left-wing activist who, as a member of the Socialist Party of Australia, towed the Moscow line after the 1968 invasion of Czechoslovakia. It is said the communists are the dominant faction in the New South Wales Greens. Adam Bandt is a former industrial lawyer and partner at Slater and Gordon, who, as a student communist at Murdoch University, opined that the only way to influence the government's agenda was to support the Greens. One should note as an aside that Ms. Gillard came to politics via the Socialist Forum and Slater and Gordon, not a dissimilar political pedigree to Adam Bandt. But today, it is no longer just Conservatives labelling the Greens extremists. Ms Gillard has found it politically necessary to do so as well. 6 months into their relationship, she is claiming that, and I quote, "The Greens will never embrace Labor's delight at sharing the values of everyday Australians in our cities, suburbs, towns and bush, who day after day do the right thing, leading purposeful and dignified lives driven by love of family and nation." End of quote. My colleague Senator Barnaby Joyce hit the nail on the head when he said, "It's like walking down the street, holding your lover's hand and yelling out, this relationship is a farce." Be that as it may, the Greens-Labor agreement is clearly already shaky. It was driven from the Labor side by the fact that after the 1st of July 2011, the Greens will hold the balance of power in the Senate. And from the Green side by the knowledge that the Labor Party was their best vehicle for implementing their left-wing agenda. From the 1st of July, the numbers in the Senate will be 34 Coalition, 31 Labor, 9 Greens, 1 DLP after an absence of 36 years, and Senator Xenophon, giving Labor and the Greens a majority of 40 out of 76 seats, and giving the Greens a veto over any Labor legislation opposed by the Coalition. Given this power, the Greens do need to be held to account. Prior and consistent statements need to be probed. Their policy program needs to be understood. So, with what are we dealing? The three areas Ms Gillard nominated as priorities in her first week as Prime Minister, illegal immigration, the mining tax and climate change, are still a mess. Her Citizens Assembly and East Timor Processing Centre were simply chimeras. By October 2010, a McKay report found that many people surveyed felt Ms Gillard stood for nothing or very little other than holding on to power. New heights of vacuity were reached when she outlined her three-year, five-point plan to a special end-of-year caucus meeting. Her plan? A stronger economy, a more sustainable environment, a fairer society, governing for all Australians and keeping Australians safe at home and strong in the world. All motherhood statements absolutely confirming that her government was bereft of any agenda. Now they tell me that vacuums aren't a natural state. They tend to get filled, especially in politics. The Greens have observed this and are busily filling the agenda vacuum with their own. The first product of the Greens-Labor agreement was the breaking of the vow made to the Australian people in full prospect of a hung parliament that there would be no carbon tax under a government led by Ms Gillard. And recall the media conference at the announcement. No treasurer, despite it being sold as a vital economic reform. There were two Labor, two Greens and two Independents, all three groupings represented as equal partners. And who dominated the conference? It was the Greens. They were telling us how they got this policy position. And of course there have been other policy positions, such as to introduce a progressive flood levy, to reignite the debate on gay marriage, to have a week-long debate on Afghanistan, to give the territories the right to make their own laws on gay unions and euthanasia, to means test the private health insurance rebate, to quietly dissolve the Work for the Dole scheme, to restore $100 million in funding for solar and rental assistance schemes, to restrict the FBT concessions on company cars, to apply $20 million to an implementation study of a high-speed rail network, and to pursue independent contractors. Now, the recent budget exemplified Labor's paralysis. Despite claiming its budget was tough, departmental officials confirmed to me at Senate estimates that the government was saving less than half a cent in every dollar over the forward estimates. And meanwhile, the government has surreptitiously introduced legislation to raise the debt ceiling from $200 to $250 billion. And despite Labor dancing to the Greens' tune, Bob Brown had the chutzpah to telephone Ms Gillard on Budget Day to complain that the relationship between the parties was too one-sided. The Greens are now on a mission to improve the budget in the Parliament. The main issues at stake, the price on carbon, along with the outcome, along with the income cut-off level for carbon tax compensation, both issues giving the Greens the opportunity to press their redistributive agenda. Ominously, on June the 29th, Senator Brown intends to outline the Greens' balance of power agenda at the National Press Club. According to Brown, the Greens will deliver stability in government while backing, and I quote, a whole range of issues that might be on the agenda now that otherwise would have been buried. So, post 1 July, we can expect plenty of Greens exhumations in the Senate. Bob Brown, who has spent his life lying in front of bulldozers, will now be able to drive one through the Australian economy. This is what the Greens' carbon and mining tax policies will do. Meanwhile, Senator Milne gives every indication she would go even further. Policies the Greens will push include higher punitive mining taxes, bringing in death taxes and expanding the capital gains tax, increasingly progressive personal taxes, cutting funding to independent schools, increasing company taxes and introducing ecological taxes, a complete ban on all live exports, pulling Australia out of ANZUS, establishing tough restrictions in vast new marine parks. And let me turn to my portfolio area, workplace relations. Recently, Adam Bandt noted that the Greens' view on employment and industrial relations would receive, quote, greater prominence after 1 July. The Greens have already led the charge to abolish the Australian Building and Construction Commission, which sought to restore the rule of law in the construction industry. Apart from that, Jim, the Greens' workplace relations settings include a 35-hour working week, a mandatory minimum of 5 weeks paid annual leave for all employees, green bargaining between workers and employers, enshrining union rights to prosecute employers in national occupational health and safety law, repealing the secondary boycott provisions, protecting unions and workers from common law actions, abolishing the requirement for secret ballots, introducing national industrial manslaughter laws, and allowing casual workers the right to challenge their termination. In recent years, unions like the CFMEU, ETU and AMWU have given the Greens over $600,000 worth in donations. Usually, this money would have been destined for Labor's coffers. This in itself provides another front for disharmony between the Alliance partners. As a Tasmanian, I trust you will forgive me for harking back to Tasmania's Labor-Green Accord. After the 1989 general election, Liberal Premier Robin Gray had 17 seats, Michael Field's Labor had 13, the Greens 5, giving them the balance of power. Two of these five Greens were Bob Brown, their unofficial leader, and Christine Milne. But when State Cabinet announced its adoption of the federal government's forest industry strategy in 1990, the Greens terminated the accord. It had lasted 409 days. The memory of this instability still casts a shadow over Tasmania and its capacity to attract much-needed investment. Mr Field later compared the relationship between Labor and the Greens to a forced marriage which ended in a very acrimonious divorce. The similarities between the Labor-Green Accord in Tasmania 20 years ago and the current Greens-Labor Alliance should not go unnoted, especially given the presence of Senators Brown and Milne. Under the present agreement, in return for support, Labor has given the Greens a commitment to a carbon tax, a pipeline into government policy formulation, and the prospect of achieving advantage through electoral reform. And while the agreement states as a goal that the parties will work together to, quote, agree that this Parliament should serve its full term, at the same time it states that the parties agree to work to pursue policies which promote the national interest and allows the Greens to move no confidence motions. While Labor may, from time to time, be humiliated by the Greens and Liberals siding together, as recently happened, to establish an inquiry into detention policy and to condemn Labor's Malaysian solution, what will occur if the coalition sides with Labor against the Greens on an issue the Greens consider is in the national interest? Earlier this year, Senator Brown was piqued when Labor and the coalition wrote to the President of the Senate to harmlessly recall the Senate an hour or so earlier than scheduled, simply to mark the Christchurch earthquake at the same time as in New Zealand. Even though efforts had been made to contact Senator Brown, it was not good enough. Now, this behaviour must be worrying for Labor. What would the Greens do if Labor and the Coalition voted in the Senate to thwart something the Greens really wanted? Already, the Labor right has split on a Senate report on the Territory's legislation, which would have advanced the Green social agenda on gay marriage and euthanasia, and there are similar strains within the Labor left on its Malaysian solution. All this suggests there could be plenty of brinkmanship in the Senate post 1 July. Despite Senator Brown telling Australians they won't have an early election, it should not be forgotten that Senators Brown and Milne have already brought down one government. Already strains between the parties are showing. The Greens have moved the first motion to condemn the government's Malaysian solution. It's not a huge step in political terms to see the Greens deeming the Malaysian solution counter to the national interest, a key principle of the Greens-Labor agreement. Now, let's remember that the Greens rejected the government's carbon pollution reduction scheme in 2009. Why? Because it didn't go far enough. So it is even possible the carbon tax could still prompt such a move. Policy differences will, without doubt, deliver government stagnation. Now, while Labor is tearing itself in two on the policy front, internal stability is also faltering with open talk about another coup. But internal stability is also a problem for the Greens. Despite claiming he would be around for decades, Senator Brown has said he hopes there will be a bit of jostling for the leadership when his parliamentary numbers increase in July, thereby making a virtue of the unavoidable. Senator Brown will turn 67 this year. Although he's not too old to be leader, the drums are beating, it's time to go. Simultaneously, the switch to Canberra by Lee Rhiannon, who herself turned 60 this year, has led to speculation of a confrontation. My colleague, Senator Michael Ronaldson, has noted that Rhiannon wants the leadership and no one will stop the Lee for leader train. Brown's putative successor is Senator Milne, but the four incoming senators appear to owe no allegiance to her. Indeed, last September, Senator Hanson Young challenged Milne for the deputy's position. Lee Rhiannon is, as I've said before, the embodiment of the old guard lefty Green that Senator Brown has sought to harness and hide at the same time. It's not hard to envisage a scenario where the left-wing senators might test Senators Brown or Milne, if not both. Small party dynamics in the Senate are volatile. The Democrats imploded amidst infighting between the young and the old, the party room and the party organisation, and over the party's direction, centrist or leftist, the very same factors latent in the new Greens party room. These internal divisions, evident in the Greens party room, do not suggest political stability for our country. A very obvious fault line in the Greens party room will be the boycott, divestment, sanctions campaign against Israel, the BDS. This policy dogged the Greens during the New South Wales campaign. Rhiannon's reaction was to simply argue that more time should have been spent building support for BDS. For this, she was publicly slapped down the same day by Senator Brown. Then on the 4th of April, Senator Brown emphatically told Lakeline that the New South Wales Greens support for BDS had been rejected by the Australian Greens National Council in 2010 and said that he also rejected this policy. 10 days later, Rhiannon told Sky's The Nation program that she continued to support the BDS against Israel, saying, quote, "We have that position in New South Wales, and I support the New South Wales position, but it's not something we're taking to the federal parliament." 2 days later, at a meeting at the ANU staged by the Green Institute, Senator Brown argued passionately for a move from a federalist to a national party structure, the spur being the New South Wales branch's BDS policy. According to one source quoted by the Canberra Times, mismanagement of the Israel boycott issue had spooked some inside the Greens because it made the party look like a bunch of radicals who were happy to fight with each other. Bob is genuinely concerned about Lee Rhiannon going into the Senate. He doesn't want to see everything he's worked for collapse, and he knows there is one or two of his federal team that could be vulnerable to people like Lee. Now, in a hitherto unnoticed blog on the 16th of May titled Greens New South Wales and the Campaign for Palestinian Rights, Lee Rhiannon has delivered her riposte. She noted remarks by Bob Brown about tolerating diverse opinions and then pointedly stated that as a confederation of parties that make up the Australian Greens, sometimes our work on national policies will vary. She then threw down the gauntlet to Brown, saying, "It is not accurate to say that the Greens National Council rejected a BDS proposal. The Australian Greens did not reject BDS. There was no vote to reject it. A less stringent boycott was supported. While the Greens New South Wales support for BDS is an expansion of the Australian Greens position, it does not contravene the national position." She goes on to say, "Despite the intimidation, misinformation and abuse in recent months directed towards the Greens New South Wales, I will not step away from speaking out for Palestinian human rights." Note this, supporting human rights for Palestinians will be part of my work as a senator. Now, this is not Bob Brown's so-called hate media inventing this, it's from his very own new colleague. The above clearly shows there is a power struggle between Rhiannon and Brown. Senator-elect Rhiannon has nailed her colours to the mast, and she would likely be backed by Senators Hanson, Young and Ludlam in her anti-Israel efforts. I should observe that BDS is also splitting the Labor Party, with Mr Rudd unable to back coalition motions condemning this anti-Israel campaign, something which would never have happened under Bob Hawke. Now, with their rise in influence, the Greens are now finally attracting critical attention. Nationally, the public is rejecting the Greens' prescriptions for climate change and wising up to how Greens' policies have driven up their water and power bills. To quote Paul Kelly, "The Green agenda has corrupted Labor values. It has seen Labor governments embrace fiscal irresponsibility, regressive income redistribution, and treat their supporters as too dumb to understand they were being played for mugs. For too long, the idea that any green scheme was a good scheme was sanctified as a compliant media cheered such initiatives. Climate change, once Labor's dream issue, has become the nightmare issue on which Labor has wedged itself. These issues and the political environment is allowing for a more robust approach to the Greens. The ACT, which recorded the lowest swing to the Greens in 2010, saw the Liberals run an aggressive anti-Greens campaign targeting Greens policies on independent schools. The Greens buckled, inventing new policy and contradicting themselves. Since then, we've seen in Victoria and New South Wales that the Greens haven't performed as well as expected. In both instances, cases of hypocrisy by the Greens candidates has been exposed, but even more importantly, Greens policies have been exposed. In Victoria, it was the Greens policies on private health insurance and death taxes. In New South Wales, it was the BDS campaign. In Victoria, the put the Greens last preference strategy was very successful, more so, if I might say, than the New South Wales open ticket strategy. It seems the public are beginning to focus on what the Greens really stand for. As a result, their relentless march has been slowed. Now, as far as the Parliament is concerned, Labor will not be able to rely on the Coalition to protect them. The suggestion that the Coalition should support legislation we oppose to stop even worse legislation that the Greens might demand is to misunderstand our principles and our resolve. We will, for example, neither support Labor's attempt to neuter the Australian Building and Construction Commission nor the Greens' attempt to abolish it. Labor will be judged and held accountable each time they break an election promise or introduce bad legislation. The new paradigm excuse simply won't wash. Labor willingly signed up with the Greens in a grab for power and can't expect the Coalition to protect them from their own alliance partner. So one scenario may be that Labor hardheads will call for an early election so as to stem the damage being caused to their base by their alliance with the Greens. I somehow think Labor might wish that it had lost the 2007 election in this state rather than the 2011 election. But in the meantime, ladies and gentlemen, please fasten your seat belts as we are about to head into some political turbulence. Thank you very much.